Welcome to the Our World Underwater Scholarship Society virtual event. I'm Steve Barnett, president of the Our World Underwater Scholarship Society. I was also a past Rolex scholar. Thank you for taking the time to join us today. Normally, right now, the Scholarship Society would be together in New York City to celebrate our returning scholars and interns and to introduce our new class to the world. However, with the COVID-19 pandemic and the unknown for the coming year, the Society's Board of Directors made the difficult decision to put all scholarship and internship activities on hold and to defer them until 2021. Now don't worry, the scholars and interns have all agreed to come back to New York next June to give their full presentations and premiere their films. We hope you will join with us to see them live and in person. Now for today, we'll hear from our three returning Rolex scholars, as well as our returning interns. We'll also catch up with some of our past scholars and interns to learn what they've been working on. Finally, be sure to stick around to the end of today's presentations when I'll be back with an announcement about our next class of Rolex Scholars and Society interns. So, to get things started, we're extremely honored to have a few words from our founding patron, Dr. Joe MacInnis.
I'm Dr. Joe MacInnis, and this is my old friend, Sea Dweller. A gift from Rolex in 1968, and she's been on my wrist ever since. During C-Lab 3, under the ice at the North Pole, down to the Titanic, I was wearing her during the James Cameron 7-mile science dive into the Mariana Trench. She's spent 10 days up on the International Space Station, but that's another story. And of course, I had her on my wrist in San Francisco in 1972 on that intoxicating night when we came up with the idea that would lead to the Rolex Scholarship. For 52 years, Sea Dweller has provided faithful service. She's a story on deep endurance. As we navigate today's turbulent times, deep endurance is an essential skill. For the COVID crisis, the climate crisis, and those other code blue events that we're living through. As members of the Rolex Scholarship family, you understand the meaning of deep endurance. You have the physical and the mental resilience to succeed in your mission, no matter how long, difficult, or dangerous. Today, as we celebrate the scholarship in a virtual way, let's use it as a time to reinforce our deep endurance, to focus on fabulous fitness for ourselves and for our family, to concentrate on our curiosity, our creativity, our courage, to be of service to others. My deepest thanks to each one of you. You are the spirit of Rolex, the spirit of the scholarship. You're tough, you're trustworthy. Your time and talent are a gift come true.
Thank you so much for those inspirational words, Dr. Joe. There's no doubt this year is providing ample opportunity to demonstrate our determination and perseverance. And now for some great examples, let's hear from our 2019 returning scholars and interns.
Hello, my name is Neha Acharya Patel, and I am the 2019 North American Rolex Scholar of the Our World Underwater Scholarship Society. Unfortunately, we aren't able to get together this year, so I'm hoping you can enjoy this video instead until we are able to see each other in person. My past scholarship year has been packed to the brim, full of unforgettable experiences. I had the honor of being the Scholarship Society's first Canadian scholar, so I was stoked that I got to spend an entire month at the Canadian High Arctic Research Station in the community of Iqaluktutiak, Nunavut. While I was there, I worked with three different Canadian research institutions that all studied different facets of this part of the Arctic Ocean. One of these was the OceanWise Vancouver Aquarium. I joined them for 2 weeks of subtitle ecological surveys. This was a beneficial experience for me, as first of all, the water was super cold, so I was able to push my diving capabilities. I also got to see some of Canada's ecosystems to which I had never been exposed. Finally, as the ocean here is covered by ice most of the year, the community is really disconnected by what exists in their own ocean backyard. So I felt really privileged that I was able to show them some of the animals that lived there. Directly after this trip, I traveled south to La Paz, Mexico, to work with an NGO called Comunidad y Biodiversidad. We went on a road trip to visit the fishing cooperatives on the west coast of the Vizcaíno Peninsula. We dove to collect and upload oxygen and temperature sensor data. This data goes to the scientists, to NGOs like COBE, but also to the fishers themselves. This allows them to make autonomous decisions when it comes to quota management. This lack of bureaucracy is really inspiring, as it has resulted in some of the most sustainable fisheries I have ever seen, as well as really cool collaboration between fishers and scientists. My final experience of the year took me to the Shetland Islands, directly north of the Antarctica Peninsula. I joined some Chilean researchers from the Universidad Mayor de Santiago to study Antarctic sponges and their microbes. This was an amazing experience as I was able to dive in such an extreme environment and also learn about the novel genetic techniques that can be used to study ecosystems like this that are being directly affected by climate change. These are just a few of the wild experiences I've had this past year. None of this would have been possible without the help and support of Rolex, the Our World Underwater Scholarship Society, and all of my hosts and sponsors, to whom I extend the most sincere thank you. I'm so looking forward to seeing you all next year.
Hi everyone, my name is Kim Hildebrandt and I'm the 2019 European Rolex Scholar of the Our World Underwater Scholarship Society. While it is very unfortunate, of course, that we cannot get together personally for our annual event in New York this year, nevertheless, I'm very happy to be able to share with you in this virtual format a little bit about what my last year has been like, because it has definitely been quite a whirlwind of a year, as you can probably imagine. First and foremost though, I would like to express my sincerest gratitude towards Rolex and the Our World Underwater Scholarship Society, as well as our amazing dive gear sponsors and all the hosts that have had me throughout the year so generously. Yeah, and although all of the experiences I've been enabled to make have certainly contributed quite a large amount towards my personal development throughout the year, I would like to share three experiences in particular with you that have helped me shape my future perspectives a little bit more. So, as I have a background in veterinary medicine and a deep fascination for aquatic wildlife, my focus has very much been on this field in the last year. And the first experience I would like to share with you is my time at the Sea Turtle Rescue Center of the Olive Ridley Project in the Maldives last July. I have been able to assist the wildlife veterinarian, Dr. Jackie Reed, and I learned a lot about sea turtle rescue, medicine, rehabilitation, but also conservation, a little bit of research and public outreach as well. So the main reason why turtles are admitted to the hospital there is that they become entangled in ghost nets, which is discarded fishing gear. Yeah, and this can cause very severe injuries to their flippers and their carapace at times as well. And luckily, the Olive Ridley Project has a fully equipped small surgery room in the Bartle. And they can help these turtles by giving surgery to them, such as flipper amputations. It's been a very eye-opening experience for me, seeing the negative impact that mankind can have on wildlife firsthand, but it's also been very rewarding because I saw that after a thorough rehabilitation process that I've been able to be a little part of, these turtles can be released back into the wild successfully and survive quite well with only three flippers as well. That's pretty amazing actually. So then followingly, in October last year, I've been able to also assist the head of animal health at the Alaska Sea Life Center, Dr. Carrie Gertz. The ASLC is an aquarium which also promotes research projects around Alaskan wildlife, but also runs a wildlife response program. And through this program, last year, two otter pups had been admitted and rehabilitated successfully in the center. Nevertheless, in contrast to the turtles in the Maldives, these two pups cannot be released back into the wild successfully. For this reason, the ASLC had already found them a new home in an aquarium in Europe. And to make their journey as smooth as possible, I have overlooked their acclimatation process to their transport boxes for 2 weeks. More precisely, I monitored them for signs of stress, such as changes in behavior or changes in also their body core temperature, which I could measure through VHF radio transmitters that they had implanted into their abdominal cavity. And this way we could respond to stressful situations in the right way and thus ensure and improve their welfare for their upcoming transport. Then lastly, I've been given the incredible opportunity to join in on a dive expedition with Oceanwide Expeditions to the Falkland Islands, South Georgia and the Antarctic Peninsula. And as you can imagine, this has been a real dream for me to come true, and I've seen fascinating wildlife such as 7 species of penguins and so many species of cetaceans and pinnipeds in their natural habitat, which was just mind-blowing really. Additionally, I've been able to dive in Antarctic waters below the 66th degree of southern latitude, which has also been quite an unforgettable experience for sure. I hope that I've been able to give you a little bit of an insight into what my last year has been like. And I'm very much looking forward to seeing many of you personally in New York next year and sharing some more parts of my journey with you then. So see you soon and take care, everyone.
Hi, everyone. My name is Joanna Smart and I'm the 2019 Australasian Rolex Scholar of the Our World Underwater Scholarship Society. My thoughts go out to all of you that have been affected by this COVID-19 crisis. I hope that wherever you are, you're safe and you're with your family or friends. I have had the most incredible year as a Rolex Scholar, and I would like to thank absolutely everyone who's been involved in my scholarship year. I think that the Rolex Scholarship has given me the opportunity to not only see the world, but to find my voice and to use that voice to speak up for what I believe in. In many ways, it's been a revolution of myself, of my confidence, of my abilities, and my experience. My scholarship year might be over, but my journeys underwater are only just beginning. I feel that I have a mountain to climb, but the Our World Underwater Scholarship Society has gotten me to the base and given me all of the tools that I need to get up. Thank you to all of my sponsors and hosts for making this year possible. To all the people who have shared their knowledge, their passion, and their homes with me, and have such an amazing passion for making sure that our oceans are sustainably utilized and appreciated. I will be forever grateful to you all and for your generosity. Stay safe, and I look forward to seeing you all in 2021.
This is Kira Jean Sapola, the 2019 Dr. Lee Summers American Academy of Underwater Sciences intern, currently teaching in New Jersey. I had an amazing time during my scientific diving internship with Moss Landing Marine Labs in California, and I'm so excited to share my research experience in the near future.
This is Liza Hassan. I was the 2019 American Academy of Underwater Sciences Mitchell Scientific Diving Research Intern. I'm checking in here from Alaska, where I'm in grad school, and I'm excited to see everyone next year.
Hi, this is Abby Dias, and I'm the 2019 Divers Alert Network Divers Safety Education Intern. This past summer, I revised Dan's safety education materials, and I'm excited to share my work again soon. I just graduated from Whitman College in Walla Walla, Washington, and hope to keep diving.
Hi, everybody. I'm Michael Langhans. I'm the 2019 National Park Service Intern. I'm currently sheltering at home in California with my family, but I'm looking forward to seeing everybody next year.
Hi, this is Ben Farmer, the 2019 Dr. Jamie L. King Reef Environmental Education Foundation intern, and I'm calling from Kentucky. I'm currently working on research remotely, and I'll be starting graduate studies at Louisiana State University in the fall. I'm really excited to share my experience in Key Largo with everybody next year. We would like to thank all of the internship hosts, sponsors, and volunteers
for making our 2019 Scholarship Society internships possible.
While we aren't sharing our incredible experiences with you until next year,
written blogs and final reports of our journeys are available online.
We can't wait to catch up with all of the supporters, friends, and family of the Our World Underwater Scholarship Society in 2021. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for those brief snapshots. Congratulations to all of you. I look forward to learning much more about your experiences when we're together again in New York next year. Now, let's hear from some of our alumni and what they've been up to.
Hello, I'm Stacy Tai. I am the 1980 scholar for the Our World Underwater Scholarship Society. This year, 2020, is my 40th anniversary of my scholarship year. Like many of you, when I began my Rolex scholarship, I thought I was already a well-balanced marine person. I had an earth sciences degree, a newly minted master's in marine biology. I was a Nawi scuba instructor and was serving as an acting dive master at a marine lab in the Caribbean. But this scholarship taught me that there was so much more. It was my own year of wet and salty heaven. Each week was a new adventure with a passionate mentor who was legendary in their field. And each adventure taught me something that I had not realized that I needed to know. During my year, I logged 42 different encounters with ocean leaders, organizations, experts, and more. Some of my favorite highlights include submersible diving in Alaska with NOAA studying the halibut fisheries, or working in North Carolina with the Duke Medical Labs and the Diving Accident Network, DAN, on deep diving mixed gases during DAN's inaugural year in 1980. And I was delighted that Howard Hall invited me to join his team for filming schooling hammerhead sharks and manta rays in the Sea of Cortez. By the end of my year, I had reached a fork in the road. Instead of becoming an ocean explorer, I pledged to become an ocean problem solver. I wanted to apply my science background to help governments, communities, organizations to better manage their marine resources. I was inspired to learn more, to do more. So I returned to graduate school, earning a PhD in marine geology and a master's, this time in marine policy. At that point, I went to Washington, D.C. for a few years as a science and policy fellow in the U.S. Agency for International Development, or USAID. In Washington, I learned about the alphabet soup of acronyms of all the marine organizations that we know and love. I spent my next 25 years working in that alphabet soup of organizations as a marine science and policy specialist in the Middle East, in the Caribbean, and in Southeast Asia. I worked on a variety of projects providing technical assistance on any coastal or marine program that they needed. For example, I just finished working on a 3-year assignment in Indonesia as the Marine Biodiversity and Conservation Advisor for the USAID Sea Project. This is a program between the government of Indonesia asking for help in developing marine protected areas for over 1 million hectares. I'm happy to report that as of now, there are 13 newly declared, established, decreed marine protected areas, totaling more than 1 million hectares, that have science-based zoning plans and operational budgets for the next year. It has been a delight along the way to host any of the other scholars who walk into my path. That has included Julie Barber, who made it to Egypt and the Red Sea, and Neha, who made it to Indonesia, and we went to Raja Ampat for some diving last year. I am humbled and honored to be a member of this unique extended family and community, and I am thankful for how it's contributed to and redirected my professional life. So, thank you for listening to my journey, and my greatest thanks goes to Rolex and the Our World Underwater Scholarship Society for changing my road to one less traveled, but far more rewarding.
Hello, everyone. My name is May Doricott, and I was the 2017 European Rolex Scholar. And I hope you've all been well and safe. And if you have been those things, I hope you've been keeping positive too about this whole crazy situation. But back to it, what have I been up to since my scholarship ended? Quite a few things. Well, basically, as soon as my scholarship finished, I had to go back and finish my master's in science communication, and I ended up focusing my thesis on plastic perceptions. How did people form their perception of plastic pollution? What was that influenced by? And following that, what did they do because of what they learned? And this was all influenced by things that I had come across during my scholarship year. So it was really nice to delve straight into that following the scholarship. But then after that, after my master's, I've kind of felt a little bit lost, and I thought, what did I really, really enjoy during my scholarship year? And that was meeting people and talking to people about what they do and the science that they do and the organisms that they study. So I thought, why not try my hand in TV like a lot of us scholars end up doing? So I ended up becoming a researcher for a Bristol-based company called Plimsoll Productions, and I'm still there now. I did a year-long project with them, which is a presenter-led program, which is like Blue Planet 2 behind the scenes meets River Monsters, as we follow an American cameraman as he tries to find new behaviors to film. So that was really cool. I got to come up with ideas for that and go around the world shooting for that too. Got to go to Colombia, Panama, Palau. That was gorgeous. Got to meet fellow scholar Steve Linfield there. And then that finished last October. And since then, I've been working still at Plimsoll Productions on a new project for an online streaming platform, which is very exciting indeed. And being in TV, it's been pretty awesome. I've loved it. I've loved the network. I've loved the mission and the drive. But I can't say, you know, I'd be there forever. I'd still like to think that there's many a different adventure still awaiting for me in the underwater world. But yeah, that's really all from me. I hope you've all been well, and I look forward to seeing you all very soon.
Hi, my name is Ronnie Noonan, and I am the 2018 Reef Intern. Since completing my internship, I've graduated with a Bachelor of Science in Marine Biology, with a focus in science communication and leadership. For this past year post-graduation, I have been exploring and trying to find my place in the world of marine conservation. Thankfully, the city I live in, Halifax, Nova Scotia, has many ocean initiatives to choose from. Safe to say, I've been wearing many hats this past year, and the most notable ones are film director for a short feature documentary on sea level rise in Nova Scotia, science communicator for an ocean-based startup here in Halifax, and on a more personal role, advocate for the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. This last role has really started to define my future. Many of you probably know what the Sustainable Development Goals, or the SDGs, are, but for those who don't, they're comprised of 17 individual goals created by the UN in 2012 to bring about a more sustainable and better world. Each goal has its own set of targets and indicators. I've listed off the ones for SDG number 14. Many of you are probably working on, if not one, but more than one of these targets and indicators for life below water. The beautiful thing about the SDGs is that when you're working on one, you're working on all of them, both directly and indirectly. The SDGs provide a great view of not only the environmental goals, but also the societal and economic goals necessary to achieve healthy oceans. As part of the 2030 agenda, all 17 goals are supposed to be at their targets in the next 10 years. We are currently a little off track for that. The biggest hindrance is lack of awareness. Many people don't even know this wonderful framework exists. The second obstacle is lack of relevance. Even when people know about the SDGs, it's difficult to understand how these exponential goals can be applied at the local level. And that subject is exactly what I want to spend my next 2 years on researching for my master's in environmental studies. I want to know what the world would look like if there was more advancement to the SDGs. What if every stakeholder adopted the SDGs into their mandate? I really want to live in a world like that. REEF and the other experiences I've had over the past 2 years have really shown me just how interdisciplinary and multi-sector saving and protecting our oceans truly is. Thank you for taking time to listen to what I'm working on and what I'm passionate about. I very much value the network of the Our World Underwater Society, and I hope our paths cross sometime soon.
Hi, I'm Megan Cook, the 2012 North American Rolex Scholar. Since my scholarship year, I've stayed very involved in the ocean space, but working now a lot deeper than scuba diving has ever carried me. I work for a deep sea exploration team called Ocean Exploration Trust, and I am their manager of education partnerships and programs. We do three things at the Trust: explore parts of the ocean that have never been explored before — there's a lot of those parts — develop the technology and tools that it takes to do missions like this, including our 4,000 and 6,000 meter rated remotely operated vehicles, and near and dear to my own heart, the third part of the mission is to take our expeditions, take all that we're learning, and use that to motivate and inspire another generation of explorers. This really is the best role I could imagine. I love the challenge of working with the variety of professionals and fields that it takes to do expeditions of this magnitude all around the world. And I'm also really inspired constantly by the challenge to keep learning and expanding what I know about our planet. On the numbers front, it has just been an incredibly rewarding few years since the scholarship. I've sailed personally on 22 expeditions on our ship, the Nautilus. I've managed and been part of the team to design almost 70 expeditions, and a milestone for me, I've now spent more than 1,000 days at sea. I love the role with a mix of managing programs, sailing at sea, and also going on the road, traveling, and speaking to students and communities about our ocean. One of the best parts, though, about my job now is that I'm in a position to award opportunities to emerging talent and other young leaders in this space. Through our at-sea internship program, I'm so proud to have been able to award more than 130 internships. And these are the types of experiences that really make me reflect and think about my scholarship experience often. These are the hands-on, experiential, get right in there with the experts, get your hands dirty kind of opportunities that just blow the doors off of the possibilities you can imagine for your career. I am so grateful to all of the mentors who helped me and provided me with these kind of experiences and challenged me to think bigger about the possibilities in our ocean world and what part I could be in those stories and in those projects. Maybe you've seen some of our recent discoveries, like the whale fall covered in octopus from Davidson Seamount, or the translucent deep staria jellyfish, or maybe the googly-eyed stubby squid or sperm whale visiting an ROV. It is always so fun to hear from the Scholarship Society friends and family around the world when one of these clips goes racing off through the internet. On the home front, it may surprise no one who knows how much I love a good challenge, but I've spent the last 2 years double-tasking my at-sea hard hat over here as a construction hard hat, and I've built 8 homes from the ground up. One of the best things about this process, aside from how much I have learned, is that our new home has multiple guest bedrooms. So I really hope to see scholarship friends and scholarship family coming through to visit here soon. The diving is cold here in the Pacific Northwest, but it is really, really great. Until then, stay well, stay safe, and I can't wait to see you all underwater sometime soon.
Hi, I'm Craig Carey. I'm the 1977 scholar for the Our World Underwater Scholarship Society. So I go way back. I just want to tell you a little bit about me. I'm a microbial ecologist, an academic. After the Our World Underwater year, I was very much encouraged to go back to school. So I did a master's degree at San Diego State University. I then went on and did a PhD at the Scripps Institution of Oceanography in San Diego, on to a postdoc in Oregon, and then on to my first position at the University of Delaware, where I was for 15 years. I then went on and took up another position here at the University of Waikato in New Zealand. The entire time since I started my graduate work, I've been working on bacteria that live in extreme environments and organisms that live in extreme environments. And this has included for 18 years of work on the seafloor and hydrothermal vents using the Alvin submersible. But it was during my sabbatical in New Zealand that I got hooked on Antarctica. And I've been, for the last 18 years, have been pretty much focused on work in Antarctica. So that actually brings me to the topic. I want to tell you about a project that's going on right now. I have a very strong collaboration with the Korean Polar Program. And we are working up in the northern part of Victoria Land, which is about almost about 1,000 kilometers north of Scott Base and McMurdo Station, which are down in the McMurdo Sound. And the reason we're working so far to the north is that this is where there are two very large Adélie penguin colonies. So climate change is obviously an extremely big issue, and as is the new marine protected area up in the northern part of Victoria Land in the Ross Sea. And so this project is really based on trying to understand how we can use penguins as sentinels for change. We spend a lot of time up in the penguin colonies. The northernmost is Cape Adare. It has just under 1 million birds. It is the largest Adélie penguin colony on the continent. But we usually hang out and camp at Cape Hallett, which is about 70 kilometers to the south, a smaller colony, but a much more tractable one in terms of size. And our big question is really to try to understand how the effects of sea ice, which is where the primary productivity that feeds the food chain for the penguins, that how the sea ice and the impact of climate change on sea ice is going to impact the colonies. But before we can even begin to even assess that and even begin to model that, we have to really understand what's happening now and how sea ice and the penguins interact. So we spend about 3 to 4 weeks up in the penguin colonies. And my job up there is to, believe it or not, is to sample penguin poo. And the reason is that the penguin poo contains both bacteria and remnants of the diet. So what we really are trying to understand is how the sea ice and the extent of the sea ice and the productivity of the sea ice is impacting the diet of the penguin and the energetics of the penguin, which will then fold back in understanding the success of the colony on a year-to-year basis. In other words, more food, the chicks are fed better, and the chicks survive. Now, there's been strong implications if we look up at the in the peninsula of Antarctica, that climate change and effects of sea ice and sea ice change dramatically affects Adélie penguins. In fact, we've seen almost a removal of many of the penguin Adélie penguin colonies, and they've been replaced by penguins that occur farther to the north. But we haven't started to see that yet down in Victoria Land, which is significantly farther south. So the idea is that this is basically foundational study to try to set the scene so that we can monitor change as it begins to happen. It's an exciting project. I'm really fortunate to be involved, and my Korean colleagues is an amazing experience. It's like living in Korea for 4 weeks in a Korean camp. I'm picking up Korean a little bit. It's not that easy, but they're gracious hosts and are very, very passionate about the Ross Sea and these Adélie penguins and what we might be able to learn from them. So I hope that gives you a little bit about what I'm doing, and it's great to talk to all of you guys, and I hope that sometime in the next year or two that we can get together at one of the society's functions and we can meet face-to-face. Thanks.
Kia ora, hello, I'm Matt Carter. I'm the 2009 Australasian Rolex Scholar for the Our World Underwater Scholarship Society. Now, I'm the third Australasian and the first Kiwi to receive the scholarship. So you can guess my vintage from there. Now, I'm a marine archaeologist, and during the scholarship and in the decade that it's been since then, I've managed to work in 12 different countries, leading and working on marine archaeological projects, which has been a lot of fun. I'm the leading technical diving marine archaeologist in Australasia, and also an early adopter of underwater photogrammetry here in the Pacific. Now, 10 years on, and I've got my doctorate. I'm the New Zealand representative on the ICOMOS International Committee on Underwater Cultural Heritage as well. And I guess, as well as these kind of academic, professional side of things, I've also moved towards the more public sphere as well. And I've worked as a TV presenter for History Channel on 3 seasons of the TV show Coast New Zealand, which was an incredible experience and a whole lot of fun. Moving today, what am I currently doing? Well, after I finished my thesis, I took up the role of research director for the Major Projects Foundation with the mission of protecting marine ecosystems from polluting World War II shipwrecks around the Pacific. Now, during the Second World War, over 3,800 ships were sunk throughout the Pacific, and estimates today believe that there are over 4 million, up to 4 million tonnes of toxic heavy fuel oil still within these shipwrecks. And one of the problems with this is they've been underwater for 75 odd years, corroding, and that means we've got between 5 and 10 years to start dealing with this problem before they corrode and leak that oil out into these vulnerable ecosystems. So in the Pacific, the highest risk areas for potentially polluting shipwrecks are Chuuk Lagoon in Micronesia, Bikini Atoll in the Marshall Islands, and Iron Bottom Sound in the Solomon Islands. Now, at Major Projects, we've started going into the field and doing some field work and to record these shipwrecks so we can start getting an understanding of how much environmental risk they pose and then prioritise them so that we can act on them and, if required, remove that oil and take that out of the equation. Now, here you can see us doing some work in Chuuk Lagoon up in Micronesia last year, and what we're doing is we're recording one of these shipwrecks, taking thousands of photos to create a 3D photogrammetric model of the ship. Now, this is just an incredibly powerful tool that's completely revolutionised marine archaeology and allows us to record the wrecks faster and in more detail than ever before. And for us at Major Projects, this is an incredible tool that allows us to move a lot faster towards removing that risk from the marine ecosystems and the cultures of these people throughout the Pacific. Now, this job is one of the largest and most challenging marine archaeological projects on the planet. And simply put, it was the Our World Underwater Scholarship Society that gave me the opportunity to get where I am today, to be able to undertake the most important job that I can as a marine archaeologist, to protect the marine environment. And I'm incredibly grateful for that. Thank you.
It's always fun to catch up on the tremendous things our society alumni are accomplishing. With a rich and diverse 46-year history that has led to 103 Rolex scholars and 107 interns, we've seen only a small sampling of all that has been achieved. In the coming months, we will share more stories about the impact past scholars and interns are making in the world today. To stay informed about the society, be sure to check out our website at owuscholarship.org and on our social media sites. On Facebook, we can be found at facebook.com/Rolex Scholarship or simply search Our World Underwater Scholarship Society, and also on Instagram at OWUSS_. Before I tell you about our new class of scholars and interns, I want to take a moment to say a few thank yous. First, to our volunteers, I'm eternally grateful. The Our World Underwater Scholarship Society is an all-volunteer organization, and our achievements have only been possible due to the hard work, dedication, and enthusiasm of our entire volunteer network. Thank you to everyone around the world who supports the society with a common commitment to our planet's environment, research, preservation, and exploration. The society is blessed to attract some of the diving community's most talented and educated people. Thank you to all of you who've contributed in your time, talent, equipment, hospitality, and generosity, both of spirit and finances, to the continued success of the society as a whole and our Rolex scholars and interns specifically. Of course, I would be remiss if I did not thank Rolex, our partner in education, who has been our founding partner and primary supporter since we awarded our first scholarship to Mark Benson in 1974. None of this would have been possible without their support. Thank you to everyone who has made this society what it is today. Now let's talk about the future. As I mentioned at the beginning of the broadcast, due to the pandemic, all scholarship and internship activities have been put on hold until 2021. However, prior to this global catastrophe, the selection committees for the three scholarship regions and the internships reviewed applications, conducted interviews, and determined the new recipients for each of the respective programs. We are especially pleased to announce that everyone who was selected has agreed to defer their scholarship or internship until 2021. It is my pleasure to introduce the 2021 class of interns. Andrew Scotty of the University of Miami will be receiving the American Academy of Underwater Sciences Mitchell Scientific Diving Research Internship. Amanda Ho of the University of California, Davis will be receiving the Dr. Lee H. Summers AAUS Scientific Diving Internship. Sarah Von Hohn of the University of Colorado Boulder will be receiving the National Park Service Research Internship. And Mary Quinn of Wheaton College will be receiving the Dr. Jamie L. King Reef Environmental Education Foundation Marine Conservation Internship. Congratulations to the 2021 interns. And now, I'm pleased to introduce the 2021 class of Rolex Scholars. Jamil Wilson of Cleveland University will become the 2021 North American Rolex Scholar. Arzukan Askin of the London School of Economics will become the 2021 European Rolex Scholar. And Amelia Mannering of the University of Otago in New Zealand will become the 2021 Australasian Rolex Scholar. Congratulations to the 2021 Rolex Scholars. To all the scholars and interns, let's keep in mind the words of Dr. Joe. You are the spirit of Rolex and of the Scholarship Society. Your talent and tenacity are a gift come true. Thank you again, Dr. Joe, for your inspirational words. Also, thank you to the scholars and interns who shared their video messages with us today, and especially to Danny Copeland for putting this video together for us. On Saturday, June 5th, 2021, the Society will come together from around the world and gather in New York City. We will host a morning symposium with the final presentations from the 2019 returning scholars and interns. Then in the evening, we will meet again for the world premieres of the year-end films of our three 2019 Rolex Scholars. We will also formally award and recognize the new 2021 Society Interns and Rolex Scholars. I hope you will plan to join us. Until then, please stay safe and stay well.